I'd like to now introduce our next speaker, Dr. Jayesh Rajan, who is familiar to most people who get over here, but quickly, he is currently the Managing Director of the Andhra Pradesh Industrial Infrastructure Corporation. He has been in the Tourism Department, in the Urban Development Authority. He has been in various rural assignments. He's been assigned on various rural assignments, and he is uniquely qualified actually to shed light on issues of development, especially in terms of the environment. He will be speaking today, however, from his experiences in the administration of watersheds. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The theme that I'll be addressing now, I have titled it Watersheds and the Poor. And given that this entire conference is focusing on sustainability, I'd like to talk about three elements of sustainability related to watersheds and the poor. Sustainability of the institutions of the poor, sustainability of pro-poor technology, and sustainability of returns that poor can get from the watershed program. Now, we all know that while poverty in general is on the decline, there are still millions of poor who live in the rural areas. And in the absence of a very diversified kind of non-farm livelihood opportunities or non-farm employment opportunities, most of the poor are still dependent upon farming, either directly as smaller marginal farmers or indirectly as agricultural laborers or users of common property resources. The watershed programs started in a structured way from late 80s, early 90s, when the Ministry of Rural Development gave common guidelines for watershed management and promoted the concept of micro watersheds at the national level, but in different states like Maharashtra, Gujarat, to some extent in Andhra Pradesh, in the drought prone areas, some initiatives, some local level initiatives on watershed management. They may not be calling it watershed management, but some kind of natural resources management was happening. And when this national guidelines came, the watershed program got a huge budget from Government of India. State governments introduced specific departments, specific agencies to handle the watershed program. Now, within a decade of experimenting or working with this micro watershed concept, it became clear that the concepts of equity were not getting addressed. The watershed programs were seen as completely a rich farmer oriented program. The watershed committees, like any other representative institution in the country, was subjected to elite capture. Only the rich landlords, the big zamindars, they became part of the watershed committees, who were at no place in it. Similarly, the technologies which were used in watershed programs, they were all contractor driven kind of technologies involving huge structures with lots of expenditure, costly machinery, material, etc. So very little scope for poor kind of technological or technical interventions. And in terms of returns also, we found a very, very puzzling kind of thing. I was the watershed project director in Andhra Pradesh for 2.5 years. And wherever I would go, I would realize that the groundwater levels, which used to be, let us say, X before the watershed implementation, which should have become more than X after the watersheds, were actually going less than X. Because the moment the groundwater would be recharged, the drawal will be much, much faster than the recharge which was happening. So indiscriminately, the rich farmers will drill bore wells, will drill pump sets, and whatever gains which were made due to the water conservation activities, they were frittered away immediately. So after a decade or so, when it was sensed that equity concerns are not getting adequately addressed in a watershed program, lots of thoughts went into it, and in the district where I was the project director, I worked as the watershed project director. It was called the drought prone areas program. There were a number of initiatives which were taken to introduce that concept of equity. And though I am no more the project director there, but I still keep track of what has happened. And I find that some initiatives which are taken at that time also, they have sustained, and then therefore there are some very important lessons to be learned on what has stood the test of time, what has withstood the onslaught of the rich against the interests of the poor. And hopefully these initiatives, if they are scaled up, if they are replicated on a larger scale, watersheds can become projects or initiatives which really benefit the poor, because we still know that non-farm livelihood opportunities are yet to take root and have not really succeeded at the scale at which we expected. So returns from natural resources for the poor are therefore very important if we are serious about improving their economic conditions, bringing them above the poverty condition. Now, of the three elements that I intend to talk about, the institutions of the poor. As I said, the watershed program is supposed to be a people-driven initiative. There are institutions which are supposed to provide that local community leadership for the watershed program. So, for example, every watershed is required to have a watershed committee, and all the people in that watershed. Actually, there is a watershed association, which is like a Gram Sabha in that impact area of that micro watershed. Whatever communities, whatever habitations are located, all members, all adult members of that impact area comprise the watershed association, like the Gram Sabha, and they in turn are expected to select a watershed committee. Now, we noticed that earlier only symbolically, because these watershed committees, etc., first of all, the watershed associations will not meet in a very transparent and open way. Even if their meetings were called for, it was not a well-informed meeting, in the sense that people will not really know what exactly is this meeting for, what are the long-term consequences, what benefits can be reaped for the villages if this committee plays an active role. So it was an uninformed kind of a gathering. Some people will come, something will be taught to them, and then they will take different views on different matters. And also in the watershed committee, there was a concept of reservation. Like, let us say if you have 10 members, 2 members will represent the Dalit community, 2 members will be women. And again, these people were only symbolically put. Some Dalit member will be asked to join there. He won't even know what is happening, which committee it is, why is he there, what is his role. Some 2 women who will be the wives of some sarpanch or some big farmer, they'll be notionally there. So only notionally, symbolically, without having any purpose, these kind of committees were constituted. Now, in Andhra Pradesh, the participation of poor in a very meaningful way in these watershed committees was really transformed with the introduction of the Velugu project. Many people will not be aware, but Andhra Pradesh is the forerunner in a very intensive community mobilization of the poorest of the poor. In fact, it was found that I can speak for 2-3 minutes on how that happened, because I was involved in that project also for a very long period of time. As we know, the poorest of the poor are continuously preoccupied with basic issues of survival. Most of them are working as farm laborers, and 24/7 questions like where are they going to find work, where are they going to get their next meal from, how are they going to settle their old loans, their old debts, how are they going to ward off people who are harassing them. These very basic questions are continuously preoccupying their minds. And if you try to mobilize them, try to create a vision, try to explain to them the importance of government programs, programs that are meant for the poor, there is very little mind space for them to really internalize and really understand and really respond to these kind of initiatives. And the other unfortunate reality is that the credibility of the government in the eyes of the poorest of the poor and also the poor is completely eroded. If you ask them what you think of the government, the instant and the spontaneous answer will be that the government is full of thieves and dacoits and rogues and people who have just no interest in the poor, who are absolutely selfish. So this is a paradox. There is a program meant for the poor, but the people who are supposed to deliver that program, they are thought of as rogues and thieves and dacoits. So, in this Velugu program, the the paradigm was completely changed. What was done was, first of all, was to keep the government away from that program. In fact, young boys and girls were taken as coordinators, community coordinators. And the next biggest thing which was done was that all these coordinators went and started living with the poorest of the poor. And not for 1 day or 4 days or 6 days or 1 week or 10 days, for months altogether. Some of the brightest young boys and girls who were recruited in the project as community coordinators, they lived with the poorest of the poor. And if you know, most of the drought prone areas in Andhra Pradesh are also coincidentally located in some of the most feudal regions. And if you understand the social distances, the social hierarchy, the poorest of the poor come at the bottomest of that social hierarchy. I found to my dismay that even animals are treated higher in the social hierarchy than the poorest of the poor. The zamindar will know the names of all his cows and buffaloes and goats, but he won't be able to identify even one poorest of the poor. For him, they are all some vast lump of people who live in the far end of the village and so on. So, for the poorest of the poor, the fact that they are getting undivided attention of a well-educated young person who is living 24/7 with them, who is facing all the trials and tribulations they face, who is becoming one of them, that created a very strong bonding. And with the help of that strong bonding, the coordinator was explained to them what they can do to kind of unite, to form into strong community organizations, to participate actively in all these government kind of programs, to benefit from these programs, to articulate their demand. And so many other things happened in the Velgu project, but the mobilization spillover was felt very, very strongly in the community organizations for the watershed projects. The community organizations of the poor, they started playing an important role. They started demanding that their concerns be also addressed by the watershed programs. As we all know, the poor's land holdings will be first of all very small. In technical terms, they are called small and marginal farmers. So having a land holding of not more than 2.5 acres. If you have land holdings up to 2.5 acres, you are a small farmer. And if you have just up to 1 acre, you are a marginal farmer. So most of the poor are either completely landless, who are the poorest of the poor, or they are small and marginal farmers. And some of them utilize the common properties. If there is some grazing ground or some other kind of common resources, degraded forests, so then the poorest and the poor make use of that also. The watershed program till then did not pay any attention to that. Most of the programs were concentrated on large holdings, how to construct some huge check dams there and things like that. So when the poor became organized, mobilized, they developed a vision that their demands can be articulated in a formal way, provided they take that leadership responsibility. So that kind of institution building, which happened through the Velgu program, worked very well in creating strong institutions of the poor for the watershed program. And I know now, after an experience of more than 10 years in social mobilization, that there are umpteen number of watersheds where the total leadership has gone into the hands of the poor. The institutions of the poor, they are called village Gram Samakhya, village organization. These are the small federations of all the self-help groups of the poor, which are federated at the panchayat level. So the village organization, the Gram Samakhya, are today controlling the watershed program. So the first priority is given to the concerns of the poor. So the lesson from this is that it is very important if institutions of the poor are mobilized strongly, and the mobilization cannot happen through some superficial kind of initiative. It requires very intensive kind of mobilization effort by a mechanism which is very credible. If you ask the government functionaries to go, in earlier watershed experiments, we used to have NGO PIS. Lots of project implementing agencies were selected from NGOs, but we found that many NGOs had similar lacunae. Their functionaries also were not really able to do what the intensive kind of field work which was required. They would also go and come like a tourist, seen in the village one day and not seen for the next 5 days. They will come riding a motorcycle. The moment you hear a motorcycle's sound outside the village, you can assume that the NGO's field worker is coming today to the village. So this is not the way in which the poor will feel bonded with that facilitator, and they will be able to get that vision, they will be able to think beyond their immediate concerns of survival, etc. So the intensive mobilization that is required to create strong institutions of the poor, that is absolutely important. The second element of watershed program, which was not really working for the poor, was the choice of technologies. Earlier, the initial watershed programs were by and large predominantly machinery focused, like you would employ heavy machinery, and they were more looking at large pieces of watershed works, like huge check dams built as the cost of some 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, etc. The government at that time started a program which was called Neeru Meeru, and one of the important components of that program was to desilt the tanks, particularly in the Rayalaseema region of the state where lots of these drought prone areas are located. They are also blessed with a chain of tanks, series of tanks, but over a period of time, due to neglect and disuse, most of the tanks had got silted up. Now, heavy machinery, those JCBs, excavators, not that kind of machinery, were deployed in large numbers, in hundreds, in thousands, to remove silt from that machinery. So the focus in the early watershed days was basically on large works, concrete, cement, expensive, machinery-oriented work, which did not really address the concept of the poor. Thereafter, certain changes were introduced when it was felt that these kind of things are not really helping the poor in any way. And then a series of good experiments were taken up in districts like Chittoor, Kadapa, Anantapur, where low-cost, simple technologies which do not require much repair, which can be managed by the community itself. So for example, rock-fill dams, rubble dams, constructing simple water diversion structures within the size of a person's small plot. As I said, the poor's plots will be small. Within that plot also, they were taught how to scientifically manage, understand the slope of the runoff pattern of that water, and construct small percolation pits. So every plot of the poor became a source of water harvesting through these small percolation pits. Then another very important innovation which was brought about is called people's estimates. Now when you have heavy machinery oriented expensive kind of works, then it requires technically qualified engineers to figure out what is happening. So they prepare estimates, and then that also gives scope to lots of corruption, because as I explained, these were the days when the community organizations were not strong, or even if they were strong, they were completely biased towards the interest of the large farmer and the rich farmer. And therefore, the scope of misusing watershed funds, diverting some funds for your personal gains, all that thing was easily happening because there were no checks and balances. All the rich farmers were all together in it. So this concept of people's estimates, in which the estimates are written in Telugu language, in simple understandable technology, instead of giving dimensions in a very typical engineering kind of style, you just write how many bags of sand are required for this work, how many bags of cement are required for this work, how much deep pit you have to dig, and things like that, which even an uneducated person can easily comprehend, and he can also monitor whether those many bags of sand were delivered or not, those many bags of cements were delivered or not, and things like that. So simple technology, low cost technology which can be understood by poor themselves in form of people's estimates, these were some of the innovations. And another innovation which again happened due to the intensive mobilization work which happened in the Velugu program was to position a number of para workers there. Now while the poor can be mobilized, they still require for a prolonged period of time some kind of social guidance, because for years, for generations, they have faced exploitation, and for them to understand that someone is exploiting them, something needs to be done unitedly to ward that off, requires continuous social guidance. While we started the mobilization effort through coordinators who were, as I said, educated boys and girls, who were employees of the project, who went to the community, started living with the poorest of the poor, but of course they could not stay in the same community for years altogether. So after the basic mobilization was done, they moved to the next village and to the next village. But what they did was that they left behind representatives from the community who were equally inspired and motivated. So we used to call them community activists. So in large number of villages where this mobilization efforts have gone off successfully, a representative of the community is still present today who is called the community activist. And lots of efforts were made to build his capacities, to create a vision in them. And he stands today as a social guide, telling the people what's happening and what needs to be done and how they need to respond to an emerging situation and so on. So technologies can also be made pro-poor, they can be simplified, they can be demystified, and they can be made to work for the poor. The third element of sustainability is about sustainability of returns from the watershed program. Now, as we all understand, watershed programs are meant to conserve the soil and moisture basically, and to recharge the groundwater by arresting the runoff. Now, all these things can do a lot in improving farm productivity and can really benefit the farmers in that area. I have known of rich farmers whose farm productivities have doubled and tripled because of the watershed program. But of course, they have also done it in an unsustainable way, so the gains were frittered after a few years. Now, one difficulty which we found with the poor is that even though they had small land holdings, they were not really able to make the best use of the watershed reserves because of their own economic compulsions. In the areas where I work, the most common crop is groundnut. So most of the poor also used to cultivate groundnut in their small land holdings. Now what happens is that if you look at the entire chain of activities, the cycle of activities which is required for farming, you plow your fields, then you buy the seeds, you treat the seeds, you sow the seeds, then some weeds come out, you kind of clear the weeds, then you water, and then you put some pesticides, etc., and then you harvest, then there is some post-harvest management. Now, in every step of this cycle, we found that the poor faced certain disadvantages. And I can elaborate about the entire chain, but since time is running out, I'll just tell about the land preparation, and the same principle applies everywhere. Now, in terms of land preparation, there is an ideal time of land preparation. When you do the plowing of your land, there is a best time when you need to plow, which is just after the first shower or the second showers, the first two showers. After that, if you plow, the micronutrients, etc., they get spread the best way, so to say. Now the reality is that at that best possible time, the poor themselves are plowing someone else's land when they should be plowing their own land, because their wage is much in demand and this is an opportunity for them to get some wage income. They neglect their own lands and they plow someone else's land and they get some wages, which is fine. But when they get the time to plow their own land, the best is behind them, the best is past them, and then they do the plowing, etc. So for every such activity in the chain, buying the seeds, soaking the seeds in chemicals, treating the seeds, planting, weeding, pesticides, harvesting, post-harvest, every stage there is some disadvantage, which I can elaborate separately. So what we did was that we introduced collectivization of many of these activities. So let the poor plow their master's lands or the big farmer's lands at that right time. But a tractor will be engaged on behalf of the self-help groups of the poor, and that tractor will plow everyone's lands together. So while you are handing on to someone else's field, someone else takes care of your field, but because the scale is too small, they just have 1 acre, 2 acre, half acre, so it is all collectivized and that activity is done. So returns also can be maximized for the poor if this kind of collectivization, if this kind of institutional support is provided to them. So as I said in the very beginning, to alleviate rural poverty when non-farm employment opportunities, livelihood opportunities are still at a very nascent stage and where natural resource based activities are best suited to help the poor, watersheds can be of tremendous advantage provided the entire orientation of watersheds become pro-poor. So I thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you very much.
People systems.
Sure.
So, how this during the financing, how these people estimates are taken?
See, it is like this, the watershed committee decides that these are the priority works which we will do. So let us say they have decided that they will construct a percolation tank worth 1 lakh rupees. So normally an engineer of the watershed implementing agency will go there, he will prepare an engineering estimate, someone will sanction and give him that 1 lakh rupees. Now instead of that engineering driven process, what would be done was that for that same work, how many bags of cement do you require, how much of stone you require to prepare the walls, how deep do you have to dig, all that is written in Telugu. It is put into simple pamphlets and that is circulated to everyone. So everyone knows that 1 lakh has been sanctioned. The output of that 1 lakh is like this.
That means people's estimate is prepared even by the engineer.
But not in engineering language. Okay. In language which is understood by the people. Alright, thank you very much.